So if you don't mind grabbing the welcome card in the seat back in front of you, filling it out, dropping it in the giving station on the way in or out of the worship room doors, we would greatly appreciate that. Again, we are so glad that you're here. Let's stand together and begin our worship.
Let us shout, be your anthem. your renown fill the sky. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your word move in power. Let what's dead come to life. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you our hearts are open, nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy. God, let your fire fall down. To you our hearts are open, nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy. God, let your fire fall down. Let it fall. Let it fall. We're here for you. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. Let every heart adore. Let every soul awake. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place.
I'm glad to be back with y'all, worshiping with y'all. I've missed you guys. I was out for 2 weeks with various things. But if you are not sick, I want you to go shake somebody's hand, probably not kiss them, just in case. Normally we would kiss, but just because there's stuff going around, we won't. But just say hello to someone, see if you can meet somebody new this morning. Seems risky.
Thank you. has a seal upon my arm. For there is love that is as strong as death. Jealousy demanding as a grave. Many waters cannot quench this love.
Believers, what he really desires is all of us, not just parts, not just Sunday morning. I did you a favor, God, I showed up at church on Sunday morning. He wants Monday through Saturday, 24/7. Our deep desire should be, God, I want to give you everything because you gave everything for me. And I pray that we don't just sing that, we believe it. Listen, we are singing, come be the fire inside of me. You know what fire does, right? It consumes. You can't put something in the fire and then pull it out the same. It consumes. So we're asking God when we sing that song to consume us. Do you mean that this morning? Do you mean, God, I want to be consumed by you? Listen, I know that you come in the room with all kinds of stuff, and it's hard. Life is hard. That's why we need this community of people. And so this morning, we want to give you an opportunity to say, God, I want you to consume me this morning. I want to lay down all the distractions and all the life's worries and cares to the side, and I want to focus on you, and I want to allow you to consume me. Because you want to say something to me this morning, and I want to hear from you. And if that's you today, maybe this morning you'd say, I need to go. I need to kneel. We got an altar right here. We got an altar over here. I need to kneel down, and I need to say, God, take it all away. Everything that's not of you. Burn up all the stuff that's not of you that I can focus on. Or maybe this morning you'd say, I just want to make a public commitment by just coming forward and standing and saying, God, I'm serious about this. Consume me. pursuing me. God, when am I going to let go? And I want these people in this room to hold me accountable to the fact that I'm saying today, I want to hear from you. So as we pray, whether you stay where you are, whether you come down here, whether you go kneel, just make this a time when you say, God, this time is about you. Help me. Help me to hear from you. Let's bow our heads, and if you need to come, you come. God, we don't want this to just be lyrics to a song. We know, God, that you pursue us. You're not going to let us go. If we claim you as our Savior, as our King, God, you want all of us. And help us, God, that we don't hold back anything from you. That we allow you to consume us. That we can be more of who you've called us to be. We can be better followers of you, that those who come in contact with us know there's something different. And we know it's you. We know it's the power of the Holy Spirit living in and through us. And this morning, God, during this time, I pray that you would take all the distractions, all the hindrances away. We would be able to say, yes, Lord, do whatever you want to do. Mold me, shape me, change me. If I need to get things out of my life and out of my heart that are not of you, I pray, God, that you would do that today. God, if I need to focus in more on who you are and be more about sharing what you've done in my life with others, and I want to do that, God, I just want to be more like you today, and I pray, God, that's our prayer. And we know, God, without the Holy Spirit just coming in, you said, your word tells us that when the disciples were gathered in an upper room, that it came in like a fire, like a mighty rushing wind. God, blow through this place today. Change us as only you can. And we will mean what we say and what we sing. And people who know us and come in contact with us will be changed because of your great love. Lord, it is in the precious, mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's continue to sing together.
I don't want to talk about you like you're not in the room. I want to look right at you. I want to sing right to you. I don't want to talk about you like you're not in the room. I want to look right at you, wanna sing right to you. I don't wanna talk about you like you're not in the room. Wanna look right at you.
Sing that one more time.
I don't wanna talk about you like you're not in the room. Wanna look right at you. Wanna sing right to you. I need you, my one. is deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are, and where you are, Lord, when I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
And where you are, Lord, Lord, I am free. Your holiness is Christ in me.
Songs rise to you. When temptation comes my way, can I stand? I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
We do love you. We're here for you this morning, God. We're here to worship you and be closer to you. We ask that you just help us to do that this morning, that you would take our distractions away, that you would help us to focus on you and your glory, God. We love you. We praise you. It's in your holy name that I pray. Amen.
All right, y'all you may be seated. Well, it's so good to see you here this morning. We are going to continue on in our study on the book of Romans. We'll be in Romans chapter 1, verses 8 through 15. Romans chapter 1, verses 8 through 15 this morning. You know, there are some times when you're, and I like to do this, preaching through a book is important because, you know, I don't get to pick and choose what I just the things that I like, but there are passages, and you should probably know this, like there are passages that just scream, man, you can preach that, right? You know, you hear people say, that'll preach. And there are passages like that. I mean, when you get to certain passages, which we're going to have a bunch of them in Romans as we move forward, where it's just like, man, I could do two or three different kinds of sermons on that passage of Scripture because it is just, it's just there, right? One of those is next week. We're going to be looking at Romans 1, 16 and 17. You know, Romans 1, 16 says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why? Because it's the power of God unto salvation for everyone. I mean, that'll preach, right? I mean, you can do it. But sometimes there are those passages of Scripture that you look at and you go, wow, this is just really more just information than anything else. And it's not. But you have to remember that all Scripture is profitable, right? Everything that God breathed into us through his holy word is useful for us. And today we get to one of these little passages that at first glance you would think, well, it's just Paul finishing up the introduction and it's really not a lot there. But as you begin to look at it, you go, wow, even though it may not be the dynamic home run hitter that a preacher might want to preach, at the same time, man, it is very important that we remember what Paul is saying in Romans 1, 8 through 15. And so we're going to read this together. If you have your copy of God's Word, you can turn to Romans chapter 1, beginning eight through verse 8. If you don't have your copy of God's Word, you can look on the screens and follow along there as I read for you. But this is what Paul says. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I mention you always in my prayers, asking that somehow by God's will I may now at last succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you, and that is that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both yours and mine. I want you to know, brothers, that I have often intended to come to you, but thus far have been prevented, in order that I may reap some harvest among you as well as among the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. Now, last week we started off this study to the letter of the letter to the Romans by Paul. And remember, we said this is when Paul sat down to write, he was just really wanting to write a letter to the believers in Rome to introduce them to a lady named Phoebe. But when he finished, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, God breathed into him this theological masterpiece. He started at the beginning and he said, let me tell you about sin. Let me tell you about salvation. Let me tell you about sanctification. Oh yeah, by the way, there's this lady that's coming. I want you to welcome her in, right? That's kind of what he does. And so today, as we look at this, now, one of the things you need to remember is this, that if we go through this letter, it's important that you try to be here, because this, everything builds on the next thing. And so if you can't make it 1 week, you can go to Facebook and we'll have it on there. We're about to hopefully get a YouTube channel going where there'll be sermons on there as well, our services on there as well. But it's important that you be here. And don't anybody say, oh, well, it's the new camera and the sound is so good, we are appreciative of those things, that we're just going to stay home. No, you need the community, right? I like to see your faces. I can't hug you and tell you how glad I am to see you if you're not here. So this is for, when you can't be here for whatever reason, you can go to those places and look. But it's important that you're here, because everything builds. And so what we have to remember, right, is the stuff that we talked about last week and as we move forward. And what Paul said last week, remember, it's always the first thing you have to remember is this letter he wrote is to who? What? Come on, believers, right? This is to believers. And so it's important that we remember that when he's talking. Who is he talking to? He is talking to believers. And he tells them the very first thing that he wanted them to know was this. I, Paul, am a bondservant of Jesus Christ. Remember what a bondservant was. A bondservant was somebody who willingly said, hey, I owe this person a debt. I'm going to be their servant and work off my debt. But after 6 years, starting the seventh year, they have to release them. But sometimes those bondservants would say, hey, my life before was terrible. Since I've been your bondservant, my life's been really good. I got a roof over my head. I got 3 meals a day. I want to stay in your service. And they would continue on. So they willingly chose to serve their master past the time that they had to. And Paul is saying, hey, I want you to know something about me. I willingly have chosen to serve Jesus Christ. I am his servant. I'm willingly giving up my life in service to him. But then he says, I'm also an apostle. I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. I am called out. I didn't call myself. God called me. I didn't do that for myself. And then he says, and my only purpose is to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Man, that we as believers would get those three things. My life is not my own. I'm laying it down. I'm serving him because he called me out. And after he called me out, it is my responsibility to proclaim the gospel. And you say, not me. I'm not a preacher. Doesn't matter. If you're a believer, it's your responsibility to share Christ everywhere you are, everywhere you go. And then Paul says, listen, it's God's grace that I can do this. It's not, I don't get any credit. God gets the credit. And my actual goal is to bring about the obedience of the faith to all people for God's glory. Bring about the obedience. Now listen, he didn't say to bring about faith in all people. He said obedience to the faith of all people. You know, anybody can say, oh yeah, I'm a believer and I have faith. But it takes a whole nother level to say, not only do I have faith, I'm living that faith out. I am obedient to the faith. I follow what God said. And Paul says, that's who I am. That's what it's all about. See, Paul knew why he existed. Before he met Christ, he thought he knew. But after he met Christ, he really knew why he existed. He knew what his purpose was. Do you know what your purpose is? If you're a believer, you should know. Here, if you're a partner, we don't have members here at Crossroads. We're not a country club, so we have partners. We are partners together to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what we do. We exist. If you don't know why we exist at Crossroads, just read it when you come in the worship room. We exist to live by faith, be known by, and reach those far from God. That's why we exist. We want to live by faith. And when we say we want to live by faith, it's not just to say we have faith. No, that's not good enough. We want to encourage each other and live out our faith in obedience to who God is. That's why we exist. And today, in the passage that we just read, Paul finishes up this introduction. It's kind of, you could say, well, no, 16 and 17 really finish up the introduction, but we're going to separate those, okay, because that's just the way I want to do it. But he kind of finishes up this introduction, and he tells these Roman believers why he is so committed to seeing his purpose completed, why he is so committed to seeing this finished work. He said, I'm going to, you know, if it was Paul standing here, he would say, I want you to know that it's not just enough for me to tell you who I am. It's more important that all these things that make up who I am, why I exist, the purpose, is finished. It is completed. I finished the mission that God has called me to do. That's important. And so he begins by, in verse 8, saying this, I want you to know that I am thankful for you. He thanks God for these Roman believers. Paul now had never met these people. He had never seen them face to face. He didn't know them in a personal way like he probably did in the churches in Corinth and Galatia and Ephesus. He knew those people. He didn't know them, but yet he was grateful for them. He was grateful for the people that he knew. Even though he had not ever met them face to face, he knew they had a deep faith like he did. He was grateful for that. Let me ask you a question this morning. Are you grateful for the people in other churches who have a deep faith? Or do we get kind of a little bit jealous? Or do we get kind of standoffish? Or do we get convicted when we're around people of great faith? Or are we grateful for those people? Are you grateful for the people at Hernando Methodist or Hernando Baptist or Colonial Hills or Life or wherever it is this morning? Are you grateful for those? Are you thankful to God? Not just, I'm talking about deep gratitude that there are other people who have deep faith. Churches can be, listen, we should all be working together, and churches, individuals, can be the most segregated places in the world. They don't want to work together. Oh my goodness, somebody might leave my congregation and go to another congregation. So what? My really good friends are pastors at the Orchard in Tupelo. They have like 6 campuses, Brian Collier and Will Rambo. And Will was here. He did revival for us. You know, phenomenal preacher. And they came. But listen, if Brian and Will called me tomorrow and said, hey, listen, we just want to give you a heads up. We bought the piece of property that's available right across the street from you, and we're putting an orchard in right there, you know what I would say? Amen. Like, we're not reaching every person, right? It's not about our kingdom. I am grateful to God for pastors and churches that have deep faith and are growing. We need to be, Paul says, I am grateful for you. And how thankful are we? Let me ask you this. Are you grateful for the people in this room that have deep faith? See, I really do believe that when we get to know somebody, one of the reasons we're not really thankful for them is because they're living out their faith. They're being obedient to the faith. And sometimes we're not being obedient to the faith. And it's not jealousy, it's conviction. When we get around them, man, they show us where we fall short. And we don't like that very much. And we're not grateful for them. As a matter of fact, we try to avoid them. When I would say the exact opposite needs to happen. We need to lean in close to those people. We need to be encouraged by those people. We need to say, hey, I want to walk in your footsteps. I want to be like you. I want to follow after you. Because, not because you're great, but because you are following after Christ. And Paul says, I'm thankful for these people. I know that they have a deep faith. It's important. It's important that we're thankful. Are you thankful for the people in your life that have encouraged you and strengthened you? And I think sometimes one of the greatest encouragements you can give to somebody else is going to that person and not saying, man, I'm thankful that you do things for me, right? Because I have people in my life. If my car breaks down, I have somebody who will help me out. It's a friend of mine, and I can go to him, and he'll help me out. He'll get the car going. Or if I have home improvement type stuff, because you may not know this about me, but I can paint anything. Like, I just, out of necessity, being married, you have to learn to do things because you can't afford to have everything paid to do, right? And so out of necessity, I've learned how to paint. Every home we've been in, I've painted every room except one, and we didn't stay there long enough. But I've painted every room. Out of necessity, I've learned. But I'm not super good with my hands, and so there are times when there are things I just can't do, and I have a friend, and I'll call him, and he'll come, and he'll help me do stuff. He probably doesn't want to, never acts like he doesn't want to, but he probably does not want to. And I can say, that's easy, right? It's easy to say, when somebody's done something for you, that's easy to say, man, thank you for, you know, helping me out with my car. Thank you for helping. Thank you for bringing that meal when I was sick. Thank you for doing something for me. But I think where we fall short sometimes is we fail to thank people who we see in them what we want to be, right? We see in them modeling and living for Christ. And we need to go to those people and we need to say, thank you for that prayer that you prayed. Or thank you, I saw you. Nobody, you were taking out the garbage at the church. I saw you doing. Just thank you for always being consistent. Thank you for always being at church. Thank you for always modeling consistency. We had dinner the other night with some friends of ours that we hadn't seen in a long time, and they brought their four kids, and we went to dinner. And afterwards, we were texting, and I just said, listen, I want to just thank you for being godly parents and raising your kids in that way. I mean, it's just, and that meant so much to them. And, you know, I think sometimes we forget to say those kinds of things because it's awkward sometimes, right? How do you say to somebody, man, I just see Christ in you? Well, that's how you do it. Real simple. But I think we miss that, and it's important that we are thankful. Paul says, not only am I thankful for you, I'm thankful for your reputation. He says, I'm thankful because your faith is being proclaimed throughout the whole earth. Why are people talking about them? I guarantee you this, they're not talking about them because they gather together once a week in a house. That's not why they're talking about them. They're talking about them because they gather together and then they go out and they actually do something. They tell people about their faith. They share with people their story. Now look, I know what you're going to say because it happens every time. You say this, but I don't know how. Like, how do you share your faith? You tell your story. You sit down with somebody and you share. Now, this year, we're going to do some stuff to help us. If you don't know how to share your faith, you know what's interesting? Of 30 years of ministry, I think maybe twice in 30 years have I had somebody come to me and say, hey, I'm really not comfortable talking about Christ with somebody. Can you help me? Can you help me get there? 30 years, I know of only one, I think it's probably two people that have said that. Who have said, I'm just not comfortable, but I want to be. How many people have been a Christian 10, 20, 30 years and have never shared their faith with one person? I think about it like this. if I've been, we've been married now, Jerry and I, we've been married 27 years this year, right? 27 years. She doesn't know. I do that because that's what husbands are supposed to do, but she doesn't know. I can tell you stories about the times we've made mistakes because she didn't know how long we've been married. But she doesn't know. It's okay. She loves me. That's all that matters. And so, but we've been married 27 years. But if I never in 27 years told anybody, like I got up in the morning, left the house, did my thing, didn't wear a ring, acted like I didn't know her, and then I'd come home. But when I got home, you're the most important thing, baby. I love you. That wouldn't make sense, would it? You would say, you don't really love her. But how many of us say, Christ is the most important thing in my life, but you never told anybody? Never told a soul about Christ and what he'd done in your life. I think Christ would look down and go, really? You really think you love me? Well, that wasn't the case for these Roman believers, obviously, because Paul says, hey, your faith is being proclaimed everywhere. Your faith is everybody's talking about you. Why? Because they were doing church right. They were doing it right. And we say, man, we want to be different here at Crossroads. We don't want to be church as usual. We don't want to be same old, same old. We know where it starts. We've already talked about it. We talked about it a couple of weeks ago. Christ said, I want you to be one. You, this community of believers, to be one. Just like Christ and the Father are one. There is no differentiation. There is no separation. They are one. If we want to be different, if we want people out there to go, something unusual is going on inside the walls. They're coming out, and they're living differently. And we got to be one, just like Christ and the Father are one. Is that possible? Well, he wouldn't have told us to do it if it was. I mean, is it hard? Yeah, it's going to be some work, but we have to do that. When we do that, you know what? That's when our faith. And Paul says, listen, and I want you to understand, this is the reason, it's because faith is an invisible thing. Like you can't, faith is just this thing, right? It's an idea. It's this, what you have. It's what you know. But once you begin to live it out, it becomes very visible. And they were living out their faith. They weren't staying hole up in some house somewhere. They were coming together, encouraging each other, and going out and doing the work. They were obedient to the faith outside the walls. We have to be obedient to the faith outside the wall. I long for us to have baptisms after baptisms after baptisms. But you know what? It's only going to happen. And churches where that does happen, we've had several, but where it's going to regularly happen is not from bringing people in and hearing me. It's from you going out and sharing your faith and bringing them back. That's when it happens. That's when Christ really gets, and that's what Paul says. He says, listen, I want you to know, I'm not saying all these things because you deserve the credit. Because you don't deserve any credit. You know that. God gets all the glory. God is the one, and when God gets the glory, that's the ultimate prize. That's the ultimate prize. We said it last week, we said it again. It's not about you. We do what we do here. Preparation for music, preparation for sermon, children's ministry, youth ministry, Bible studies on Wednesday night. We're having men's ministry stuff. We've got women's ministry Bible study stuff going on. Everything that we do is not for us. It's to bring glory to God because he is honored when people grow. That foundation that they have is deepened and widened and strengthened. God gets the glory. And if we try to take any of that, listen, that is when we are not living our faith, being obedient to the faith. Paul understood that. Paul understood that they have to be people who, they were people who shared their faith, talked about their faith, but they knew they weren't getting the glory. God is the one who gets all the glory. It belongs to the Lord. Paul says it in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 when he talks about, for by grace are you saved through faith, is not of works, lest any man should boast. You can't even take credit for that. You don't have any part in that. It's all God, because if we try to take part in that, if we try to think that we have some part to play, you know what we start doing? We start taking credit. We start trying to get a little bit of glory. We start doing that. And Paul says, that's not what it's about. And so Paul is really thankful for people who have the kind of faith that produces obedience. Listen, we're talking about this today. Next week, we're going to talk about the gospel. But after that, hold on to your hat, because from verse 18 to the chapter 8, it's all about sin, right? And you're like, you'll be wishing we could come back, right? I know, I'm already, holy cow. But Paul, he is thankful for people who have the kind of faith that produces obedience that is known throughout the world. If we're going to be known for something in this community, if we're going to be known for something in this state, if we're going to be known for something in this world, see, in our minds, we can't even fathom that. How are we going to be known in the world? That if we're going to be known, we're going to have faith that produces obedience. That's when we will make a difference. That's when we'll make an impact. And it's not from avoiding what we're going to be talking about for the next however many weeks. Right? We can't just say, oh, I don't like talking about sin. I'm just not going to talk about it. Well, we got to talk about it. Because it's obedience. We start to get rid of this junk in our lives that are keeping us from being like Christ. And that's when it makes all the difference in the world. God gets the glory when we do church the right way. And they were doing church the right way. And then Paul says, listen, I want you to know this. I pray for you constantly. I pray for you continually. He didn't know them and he prayed for them. I think there's something special about praying for something over and over and over again. Not missing a day. Not missing a day. We're praying, and God, you're going to answer or you're not going to answer. Eventually, you're going to answer. You're going to give us yes, no, maybe. I don't know, but we're not giving up. When we have new leadership team come on, we give them a copy of The Circle Maker by Mark Batterson, and it's a book about prayer. If you hadn't read it, highly recommend it. But one of the things that we want them to read that, because one of the things that it talks about in there is this idea that when you have something that you want to pray for, that every day praying for that thing makes a difference. That's the circle, right? It's almost like you're drawing a circle around that thing and saying, God, I'm not leaving the circle until you answer. And us not leaving the circle is coming back day after day after day after day and praying day after day after day. Paul says, I pray for you constantly because I know what you're going through. I know what you're doing is not easy. I know that all those things make a difference. And he says, I pray for you. Listen, do we pray for each other? Like, I know that at times you probably lift up this service. You know, I know you do. And here's what I believe. We meet together. We pray on Friday night. We pray at 8:30 on Sunday morning. We pray at 10 o'clock, 10:30 on Sunday morning. We pray for this service. And one of the things that we constantly ask is that the Holy Spirit will just pour out on this place. Like, I don't even know really what I'm asking for. I don't want to presume to ask God to do something just this much when he's willing to do this much. So we just ask God, you do whatever you want. Just pour out in this place. And I keep praying and I keep praying. And I think we've seen glimpses of it. But here's what I believe. I believe that one day we're going to keep praying and keep praying and keep praying. And it's going to be like a rushing wind that blows through this place. And it's going to change everything. Because we're going to keep on praying. We're going to pray and pray and pray. I think it's interesting when we have a very horrible circumstance in our lives, right? When we have a problem, sick child, you know, something real, or we get a bad diagnosis, or whatever it is, right? We pray constantly about that thing. And I think that's great. But I often wonder what God thinks. When everything's going pretty good, got a little money in the bank, why then are you not praying? God, do something unexpected. God, what do you want me to do in this moment? What are you trying to teach me? Because I don't have any real problems right now. What can I do? How can I help somebody else? And we pray over and over and over. I've had people come to me and say, listen, man, I really want to serve God more. I just want to do more for God. But I don't know what to do. Pray. You know what happens in those moments? A day or two. God, I want to do more. Show me. Give me an opportunity. Then you get distracted. Don't pray about it. I think God goes, man, you didn't really want that very bad, did you? We pray constantly. Things happen. Things change. And Paul said, you guys are doing great. You're doing great. But I still long to come and to help you along the way. I still long to come face to face and to encourage you. And the reason I want to come and encourage you is because you're going to encourage me. Right? You're going to encourage me. And maybe, I don't know, but I just believe that there are people who we could encourage each other. Right? Women do a much better job of this than men do. We men need that more than we realize. Other men, being around other men and having a time with other men where we can just talk about life and be encouraged by one another. I mean, we've been taught that we don't need each other, and that is so not the case. We probably need each other now more than ever in the history of our world. On February 16th, we're going to start, Josh Freeman's going to start a men's ministry event once a month. That's what it's going to be for. It's called The Forge. I'll let him tell you another time about that. We're going to be meeting together. And listen, I know right now in your mind there are already excuses and reasons that you don't want to come. But I promise you, if you come, you will not regret coming. I promise you that it is something that some of you don't even realize you have a deep need for. There is a deep need in men. The Bible says as iron sharpens iron, right? We have to sharpen one another. And I don't think we'll ever be the kind of church that we need to be until our men step up and be who God has called us to be. That's just, I think God wants to do some mighty things through this place. I really do. But I think he's waiting on the men to step up and be who God's called us to be. That's what I believe. Paul tells them, you are doing great, but we can always do more. And so I want to come and encourage you. I want to come and share with you some spiritual truths, and I want you to do the same for me. Paul is saying to them, I don't have all the answers, and neither do you. But together, hey, maybe we can get a few more things right. And I think together, we can get a few more things right. I think that's why it's important that we have Wednesday nights and Bible studies and small groups and all the things that we have going on, because together we can do that. He says, listen, you new believers can encourage older ones. You know why? Because they've got that excitement. They got that zeal. Older believers can encourage new believers. You know why? Because they've had the experience. They have the wisdom. And all of that works together. That's why we need each other in this community of faith. So if you say, well, I'm just a young Christian, I don't have much to offer. Oh, yes, you do. Because some of us who have been Christians for a lot of years can sometimes get stale. And we can forget the purpose of why we're here and what we're doing. And for us who are new Christians, for us who are older, more seasoned Christians, we can forget that we have some things to offer. We've seen pitfalls that these younger believers may go into if they're not careful, and we can share those. That's why we need each other. And then finally, Paul says, I am under obligation. The obligation I am under is to the Greeks and the barbarians. Why does he say that? He's talking about everybody in the Greco-Roman world. Everybody. So what he's saying is, I'm under obligation to everyone. There's nobody left out. And then just to make sure they understand, he says, I'm under obligation to the wise and the foolish. Everybody falls in one of those categories, right? Everybody. I am under obligation to everyone. Paul understands this. My debt is to God. But the repayment is to man. I'm under obligation to everybody. Paul knows I want to use my life up pouring out the gospel to everyone. Everybody deserves an opportunity. Everybody deserves a chance. Everybody needs to hear, and I'm willing to do that. Paul sees himself as this person who cannot rest until the gospel has been shared to everyone. Let me ask you a question. As a believer, is your desire to see the gospel shared to everyone? Or is your desire just to come to church and be a little better today than you were yesterday? If that's the case, we have missed something somewhere. Our passion, our desire, everything that we are should be, hey, I have an obligation. I have a responsibility. We don't like to do that. I got enough responsibility, preacher. I don't need any more. Well, if you've claimed the name of Christ, you don't have a choice. You have a responsibility. And the responsibility is obedience to the faith, sharing Christ with everyone. There's a great missionary to China. His name was Hudson Taylor. And Hudson Taylor understood, like Paul, because somebody suggested to him that he had given his life to the Orient because he loved the Chinese. And Hudson Taylor shook his head and said, no, not because I love the Chinese, because I loved God. I didn't give my life in service to the Chinese. I gave my life in service to God. I just happened to do it in China. Listen. Are we giving our lives? Are we pouring ourselves out? Because we love God. We love God. That's the most important thing. We who claim the name of Christ are debtors to our fellow man. I think Paul's theme would have been this: love God, love people. Simple. Love God, love people. You know what that doesn't say? Love God, love myself, love God, love people. And then love God, love people. I think if we focus our energy and our efforts on loving God and loving people, God will be pleased. God will be glorified. God will get the honor and the praise that he rightfully deserves. This morning, I would say this. Maybe there's somebody in this room, and you just need to go to that person this morning. You need to say, I hadn't said this, but I want to thank you for the way you've lived. You didn't even know it. It encourages me. It just encourages me. I'm a better follower of Christ because I see him in you. You want to talk about giving somebody encouragement. That's better than any kind of thing. That's the best encouragement they can get. Maybe this morning you need to do that. Maybe this morning you need to come and say, you know what, I've never said yes to Jesus for the first time. Never have. I've been to church, I've come, but man, I don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Or maybe this morning you would say, I think Crossroads is the place I want to partner so that we can begin to reach this community with the gospel. Or finally this morning, maybe you just want to kneel and say, God, I've been all about myself for too long. Change me. Change me so that my desire is you and only you. I think if we have a church full of people who have that desire, our faith will be proclaimed in the world. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for today and this opportunity that we have here. God, I just pray that this morning we would have a desire to follow you. To give you everything. God, I pray that we would be willing to say, it's not about us. We want every human on the face of the earth to hear the gospel. And we will not rest until that mission has been completed, just like Paul. God, do your will now. Lord, in your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand with heads bowed and eyes closed this morning. Jesse's going to play. We're not going to sing. But if you need to go talk to somebody this morning, you have that opportunity. There's going to be some people standing in the back. If you want somebody to pray with you, you can walk to the back. I'll be here up front. If you want to pray with me, you can come. Or if you want to join our partner with Crossroads, you can come. or you can come and kneel at the altars and pray. As Jesse plays, whatever God has led on your heart to do,